Lazy fetching and join fetch clauses or entity graphs are common best practices to efficiently fetch entities and their relationships. They work great most of the time. But for a very common mapping, Hibernate ignores your lazy fetching definition, and there are two situations in which join fetch clauses and entity graphs create their own performance issues. In this video, I will show you those pitfalls, explain how to find them in your application, and what to do to fix those performance problems. Let's start with the situation in which Hibernate ignores your lazy fetching definition. It does that for one side of a bidirectional one-to-one relationship. This problem is especially annoying because your entity mapping looks like you did everything right, and only if you check the executed SQL statements, you can see that Hibernate ignores your fetching definition. But why does it do that? It's because Hibernate has to execute a query anyway. Let me show you why. I'm using a book and a manuscript entity with a bidirectional one-to-one relationship between them. The book table contains the foreign key reference to the manuscript table. This one-to-one annotation defines the relationship between the entities. Here you can define lazy fetching. That's because when Hibernate gets a book entity from the database, it selects all mapped columns from the book table, including the foreign key reference. Due to that, Hibernate knows if the foreign key is set or empty. Based on that information, it can initialize the manuscript property with a proxy object that handles lazy loading, or with null if the foreign key is not set. So there's no problem. The problem is on the other side of this bidirectional relationship. You can see that when I run this test case. It only fetches a manuscript entity and doesn't access the book relationship. So there shouldn't be any reason to fetch it from the database. But as you can see here, Hibernate executed a second query to get the record from the book table with a foreign key reference to this manuscript. And the reason for that is in the table model. When you model a one-to-one relationship between two tables, you add a foreign key to only one of them. In my example, that's the book table. The manuscript table doesn't contain a foreign key column. So, in contrast to the bidirectional relationship in the entity model, there's only a unidirectional relationship from the book to the manuscript in the table model. That causes some problems when Hibernate fetches a record from the manuscript table and maps it to an entity object. That record doesn't include any information about the one-to-one relationship to a book. So Hibernate doesn't know if it has to initialize the book property with null or a proxy object providing the lazy loading mechanism. The only way to answer that question is to execute a second query that checks if there's a record in the book table with a foreign key reference to the manuscript record Hibernate currently maps to an entity object. And if you have to execute a query anyway, the Hibernate team decided to apply eager fetching and get the entire record instead of just the primary key. I think that decision makes a lot of sense because in many cases getting the primary key value is not that much faster than getting the entire record. And it saves us another query in case we actually use that relationship. Okay, that explains why Hibernate ignores lazy fetching, but we still don't want to execute the second query, right? So, what can you do about it? Your only option is to avoid bidirectional one-to-one relationships. And don't worry, you don't really need a bidirectional relationship. You can model a unidirectional relationship, and when you want to get the book entity that belongs to a manuscript, you can use a simple JBQA query. Let me show you an example. I remove the book relationship from the manuscript entity. Now it's a unidirectional one-to-one relationship from the book to the manuscript. This test case gets a manuscript entity from the database. I removed the relationship to the book entity, so I can no longer traverse it to get the book. Instead, I execute this query to get the book entity from the database. As you see, this doesn't require a lot of code, and it gets even better if you implement this as a method of your book repository or book DAO class. You can then easily call this method from your business code whenever you need to get a book for a manuscript. The query that I execute here is the same one that Hibernate previously automatically executed when instantiating a manuscript entity. But the main difference is that I can now decide if my business code actually needs the book or not. And I only execute the exact query if I need the information. Okay, let's talk about the second pitfall. The one where join fetch clauses and entity graphs solve the n plus one select issue, but replace it with a new performance problem. I already shortly touched on that topic in my previous video about join fetch clauses, but this time I want to get into a few more details and offer you two additional solutions. If you define a query with a join fetch clause or an entity graph, you tell Hibernate to get some entities and initialize the join fetched relationships. This requires Hibernate to join the tables mapped by that relationship and select all attributes mapped by both entity classes. The problem with that is that it creates a product in your result set. In this example, the result set contains unique combinations of each author and their books. Each combination is a separate record in the result set. So if you select one author who has written 5 books, your result set contains 5 records. Each record contains the information of the same author and a different book. That's just how SQL works, and there's nothing you can do about it. But you have to be aware of this and when it causes problems. And that's when the join-fetch relationship contains many records or when you join-fetch multiple relationships. Because every additional relationship multiplies that product with its own cardinality. Let's say the author wrote 5 books and there are 100 reviews for each book. The result set then contains 500 records just to get that one author entity with their books and reviews. I hope it's obvious how easily this can get out of control and create a result set that's too huge for the database to handle efficiently and for Hibernate to map to entity objects. So, what can we do about that? One common recommendation is to not join fetch more than one relationship. I don't agree with that, because you can fetch as many relationships as you want as long as your result set doesn't get too big. So you can easily join fetch 5 or even more relationships if all of them are small, but fetching one huge relationship, like the reviews of a book in a popular online bookstore, can already cause a problem. If you want to keep it simple, you could instead define batch fetching for your relationships and rely on Hibernate's normal lazy loading. You do that by annotating the relationship with an additional batch size annotation. It defines the number of entities for which Hibernate shall fetch this relationship in one query. Let's set it to 10 and see what happens. This test case executes a query that gets an author with their books, and when processing the result, I get the review relationship and count the number of elements. The query doesn't get the reviews relationship, so Hibernate has to fetch it when I use it for the first time. Without the batch size definition, this would trigger one additional query for every book entity. That's the well-known n plus one select issue I discussed in a previous video. But with a batch size annotation, Hibernate fetches the reviews relationship for multiple books in one query using an in clause. This obviously reduces the number of executed queries drastically and is a good approach when you can't join fetch the additional relationship. But it shouldn't be your default solution, because this still executes more queries than a join fetch clause. That's why you should try a join fetch clause first, and only use the batch size annotation if that doesn't work. A more complex but also more efficient approach to join fetch multiple relationships is to split it up into multiple queries. I did that here. I first get all books written by a specific author and tell Hibernate to join fetch the reviews relationship. After that, I execute another query that selects that author and join fetches the books relationship. As you can see in the log output, Hibernate puts the results of both queries together so that it gets the author with their books and all reviews of those books. But why does it work? It works because Hibernate stores all entity objects you fetched during a transaction in the first level cache. And when it maps the result of a query to entity objects, it first checks if the first level cache already contains that object. If it does, it uses the object from the cache. So in this example, the first query got all book entities with an initialized reviews relationship and Hibernate put them in the first level cache. When it mapped the result of the second query, it got the author entities with an initialized books relationship. But before it gets a book from the result set, it first checks the first level cache to see if it already contains that entity. Because I selected them in the first query, Hibernate finds the objects in the first level cache and uses them to initialize the books relationship. And because the previous query fetched those books with their reviews, the relationship is still initialized and we get all the information we were looking for. That's a nice trick, isn't it? But I have to warn you, doing this on a more complex domain model with more relationships can be tricky. And unfortunately, it's not the only thing you need to know about join fetch clauses and entity graphs. They also cause problems if you combine them with a query that uses a limit clause to only fetch a part of the result set, like the one I used in this test case. When I run this, Hibernate writes a warning to the doc file telling us that it fetches the entire result set and performs the limit operation in memory. But hear me out before you start blaming Hibernate for that. There's a simple reason for it. When I added this limit clause, I did that to limit the number of authors to a maximum of 5. I wanted to get each of them with an initialized books relationship, and the fetching of that relationship causes the problem. As discussed earlier, this creates a product in the result set. It contains each author as often as they've written books. So, what's Hibernate supposed to set as the limit in the SQL query? In the JPQA query, I defined a limit of 5 authors. But before Hibernate executes the query, it doesn't know how many records it has to retrieve to get the first 5 authors with all their books. There could be 5 if each of them only wrote a book, 15 if each of them wrote 3 books, or it could be any other number of records. We simply don't know. And because Hibernate doesn't know that either, it fetches all of them and applies the limit operation in memory. It's the only thing Hibernate can do, but it's also exactly what we want to avoid by adding the limit clause. The good news is there is an easy workaround to fix that. You first have to perform a query that only gets the primary key value of the records you want to fetch. In this case, that's a simple query that selects the ID property of all author entities and limits the result set to the first 5. After that, you can perform a query that fetches the entities and initializes the required relationship. In this example, I select the author entities for those 5 IDs and tell Hibernate to initialize the books relationship.
This again shows that best practices like lazy fetching and join fetch clauses work great in most situations, but not always. If you want to be sure you get the most out of your persistence layer, you really have to understand how Hibernate works and the strengths and weaknesses of its features. And the easiest way to get all that knowledge is to join my free email newsletter. In less than 10 minutes a day, you'll learn something new about Hibernate, and I'll guide you on your journey to becoming a Hibernate expert. Go to torbenjanssen.com/newsletter to join and start improving your Hibernate skills.